This video presentation represents the pre-lab discussion for the first experiment, spectrophotometric determination of iron. In this experiment, we'll find ourselves determining the percentage of iron in an unknown sample using the technique of spectrophotometry. This experiment is the first of two unknown experiments. You want to be sure to do the calculations correctly, and should you have any questions, contact your instructor. Now, the basis for this experiment, that is the basis for spectrophotometry, is the Beer-Lambert law, or simply speaking, Beer's law. Beer is, of course, Mr. Dadson's favorite drink. It's up there on his list of things he enjoys, along with courtroom drama. In fact, if you combine these two, alcohol and courtroom drama, you have, well, an activity that easily makes Mr. Dadson's list of top 10. Now that said, what you're looking at has nothing to do with Beer's law. In fact, even this last picture of Lambert himself walking the line after being pulled over for drunk driving also has nothing to do with Beer's law. Beer's law is a relationship between concentration and the absorbance of light. In fact, we can write the Beer-Lambert law as an equation to illustrate this relationship. In this equation, A is the absorbance of light, that is the amount of light that's absorbed upon passing through a solution. Epsilon is the absorptivity coefficient, and it reflects, if you will, how well a substance absorbs light at a given wavelength. B is path length. It represents the distance that light travels through the solution. Typically, it's 1 centimeter. C is the concentration of the solution. Clear from this relationship, absorbance is proportional to concentration. And we'll come back to that in a minute. But first, let's give some thought to the units. The units for concentration vary. Whereas they might normally be molarity, for this experiment, they will be milligrams per milliliter of solution. Path length is almost always going to have units of centimeters. And the absorptivity coefficient, well, this has units which are the inverse units for path length and concentration. That is, milliliters per milligram centimeter. Units which ensure that absorbance itself in this expression is unitless. Now, back to it. The Beer-Lambert law provides a relationship between absorbance and concentration, such that for greater concentration, I would expect to see a greater absorbance of light, which of course results in a darker solution, as less light passes through. To illustrate this concept, consider solutions A through G. G, by the way, is probably just the solvent itself, like just water by itself, and as such, not absorbing any visible light. But there's a clear variation between solutions A to F, A being darker than B, which is darker than C, and so forth all the way through to F. That variation in the color from darker to lighter reflects a variation in concentration. A is most concentrated and therefore darkest. F is least concentrated and therefore lightest in color. Now, by measuring the absorbance of various solutions of differing concentration, such as the solutions in the previous screen, we can produce a plot. That plot is referred to as a Beer-Lambert plot. Italicized, bold, and underlined for emphasis. A Beer-Lambert plot is a plot of absorbance, which again has no units, versus concentration, which for this experiment will have units of milligram per milliliter. There you go. This is an example of a Beer-Lambert plot. Notice the general linear nature of the data points. Also notice that we have absorbance on the y-axis, concentration on the x, because again, it's absorbance versus concentration, y versus x. Here we have five data points, which represent the five data points from five absorbance values of solutions of various concentrations. The sixth data point is what you'd obtain if you measured the absorbance of a solution, which was nothing more than the solvent itself, like just water or just alcohol. Zero concentration of the solute, and therefore we expect zero absorbance of light. These six data points produce a linear trend line. That is to say, they fit a linear trend line, the equation for which is given to us on the screen. Note that in addition to the equation, we have the R squared value, the square of the correlation coefficient, which, as you previously learned, gives us a measure as to how well the data fit the trend line. The closer to one, the better the fit. Here, the data exhibit a small amount of scatter. Hence, the R squared value is not one, but is slightly less than one. Now, we use the equation of the best fit trend line to determine the concentration of an unknown solution. The process by which this happens is straightforward to understand. Let's begin by giving consideration to the equation of the trend line, which we obtained on the plot on the previous screen. In this equation, y is the absorbance, and the slope of 203.37 will have units which are the inverse of the concentration. The concentration, represented by x, has units in milligrams per milliliter, and so the slope is milliliter per milligram. The intercept has the same units as the y-axis, which in this case has no units at all. This is the equation of the trend line given to us. But in actuality, what you see now is what we're really working with. So, continuing, imagine we produce a Beer-Lambert plot, and then we go about measuring the absorbance of an unknown solution. With the measured absorbance of 0.321, we go about solving for the concentration. We plug in the absorbance of 0.321, and then we solve for the unknown concentration, which in this example works out to be 1.57 times 10 to the minus 3 milligrams per milliliter. In case you're wondering, this is what we get to do. In this experiment, we'll find ourselves producing five standard iron solutions. And from those five standards, we will produce a Beer-Lambert plot. Then, we'll produce five unknown iron solutions. We measure the absorbance of those unknowns, and then calculate the concentration of iron in the unknown using our Beer-Lambert plot. Let's consider the experiment itself. In part one of the experiment, we're going to pipette different amounts of a stock solution, 0.050 milligram per milliliter iron 3 solution. We'll pipette this solution into 5 different volumetric flasks. To each of these flasks, we're going to add ammonium acetate, that is a buffer solution, hydroxylamine hydrochloride, that is a reducing agent, and we'll also pipette 110 phenanthrolane, which is our complexing agent, our chelate. We're then going to go about adding water, diluting this mixture to volume in the volumetric flask. We'll mix it up and we'll wait and we'll wait. And that's pretty much close to an eternity that we'll find ourselves waiting. That is, we're going to provide time for reactions to occur. One reaction will be the reduction of iron 3 with the hydroxylamine. This reduction reaction, I should say redox reaction, which appears on the screen, we'll see the reduction of iron 3 to form iron 2. The iron 2 produced in this reduction, this redox process, is then going to react with the 110 phenanthrolane to produce our complex. Our complex is going to have a single iron 2 surrounded by 3 110 phenanthrolanes. The 110 phenanthrolane is bidentate, and therefore this will be an octahedral complex. Continuing, in part 2 of the experiment, we'll use a SpectroVis probe so as to obtain the absorption spectrum of our complex. That is the absorption spectrum of the TRIS 110 phenanthrolane iron 2. The SpectroVis probe, of course, is no different than what you would have seen in the first semester course during the Coolidge experiment. It's simply a device that allows us to measure the absorbance of light by a sample, the sample which is poured into a small plastic cuvette. The device itself will provide us with what's termed an absorption spectrum. That is, it tells us how much light is being absorbed at the different wavelengths of light. There will, of course, be a maximum absorption, and it's at that wavelength where we find the absorption maximum that we conduct our studies. The absorption maximum for TRIS 110 phenanthrolane iron 2 is fairly near 500 nanometers. And of course, with the absorption of this bluish green light, we expect the solution to be reddish orange in color. In part 3 of the experiment, we'll find ourselves measuring the absorbance of the 5 standard solutions prepared in part 1. We'll also measure the absorbance of the blank, that is a cuvette filled with just deionized water. We'll produce a Beer-Lambert plot from those 6 measured absorbance values. And then we move on to part 4 of the experiment. In part 4, we'll measure out between 0.06 and 0.08 grams of an unknown iron sample, and then dissolve that sample into 50 milliliters of deionized water. We'll pipette 1 milliliter aliquots of the solution into 5 different 50 milliliter volumetric flasks, and then prepare the complex as we did in part 1. That is, we'll add ammonium acetate, hydroxylamine, and the 110 phenanthrolane. With the TRIS 110 phenanthrolane iron 2 complex produced, we then go about measuring the absorbance for each of these five different solutions at the wavelength of maximum absorbance. Once those five measured absorbance values are obtained, we get to go about doing calculations. Before we talk about the calculations, let's spend a moment thinking about the data. Again, in part three, we're going to record the absorbance for solutions 1 through 5 and the blank. In part four, we'll measure the absorbance of 5 unknown solutions. Additionally, we want to be sure to record the unknown number and the mass of unknown used in part four. Regarding the calculations, there isn't much to say here that you probably haven't seen before. In part one, we produced the standards. The concentrations of these standards are determined using the dilution equation. Ci is the concentration of your standard, which is found by taking the product of the initial concentration of the iron standard solution with the volume used. We'll then divide that by the total volume of the solution. The Beer-Lambert plot is produced from the data we obtain. And again, this will be absorbance on the y-axis versus concentration on the x. We then will use the Beer-Lambert plot and the trend line obtained to calculate the concentration of iron in the unknown samples. Again, we'll be using the trend line. We'll be solving for x, given the measured values, which represent y. You might expect to calculate the mean as well as a standard deviation. And then, in the final step, we'll calculate the percentage of iron. We use the following equation. That is the average concentration multiplied by 50 by 50 divided by the sample mass multiplied by 10 to the minus 3 times 100. Looks pretty straightforward, but it certainly wouldn't help to run through a calculation together. Imagine upon finishing calculation number 3, you have 5 values for the concentration of iron. You average those values and we get 9.63 times 10 to the minus 3 milligrams per milliliter. We multiply that by the 50 over 1 and again by the 50 over the sample mass, which for the purpose of this example, let's take to be 0.0678 grams. Multiply by 10 to the minus 3 and then by 100 to yield percentage, and perhaps I obtain a value of 35.5%. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. Understand, of course, before you walk away, the values in red represent those values that you yourself will obtain. Your measured concentrations, your measured mass, your measured percentage. Here, we have the king, and he's telling us what we have to do for this experiment isn't that bad. It's pretty straightforward, right? And with that said, I would have you get to it. Enjoy the experiment, enjoy the chemistry, and maybe wish upon a star going forward that we can get back into the lab and do these experiments together.